Good day, liberators and fellow South Africans. I must apologize that I was always under the impression that you, as the citizens and our supporters, actually understand the great excitement that we've revealed the past 2 weeks. And I was wondering why you are not excited until last night that a well-known vlogger activist, after I've sent the papers we've received, the exciting news we've received yesterday, on the 20th of November 2024, he responded, "In summary, what does this mean?" So I've realized, Reyno, you've been living this for many years, especially since 2019. And you've been engaged in this on a daily basis, and you cannot assume that the people, although we've reported regularly on what we are doing, what we're busy with, I cannot assume that you actually know what I know. And I have to come to your level and just downgrade myself to your level so that you can understand. And I do apologize that this video will most probably be not 1 or 2 minutes. It's going to be several minutes. And I want you to please download this video, save this video. If you don't have time to watch it now, please save it. Watch it at another time convenient to you, and share this with your family and friends, because what I'm going to reveal in this video is extremely important for our constitutional democracy and the development thereof within the next couple of years going forward. This is most probably, and I'm not just saying this because this is my video, I'm saying this because I know that this is most probably the biggest constitutional news since 1994. This is something that should have been addressed in the interim constitution of 1993, and it has only come now, 30 years after our democracy, these developments are now happening. And that is why I'm very much excited, because Liberty Fighters Network and I have been driving this for you as the people of South Africa. And this is really something that you have to know and understand. And let me fall into the house and start to explain. Our democracy, in terms of our constitution, is built on three independent pillars. It's the legislative pillar, it's the executive pillar, and the judicial or courts pillar. Now, all of them are functioning individually, independent from one another. And in terms of the so-called doctrine of separation of powers, the one pillar may not interfere with the work of the other, and only in certain circumstances there can be an interference from the judiciary courts pillar when the decisions taken by either the executive or the legislative pillar were not constitutionally aligned, and then the judiciary can then set aside those decisions, but have to send it back to Parliament for consideration and rectification. So what has happened now is that, especially the past 4 years or so, we've seen very much strange and awkward judgments by especially the Constitutional Court. One of them, well known, is the fact that the Constitutional Court, which was the first and final court, made a decision that Jacob Zuma, our former president, had to go to prison for contempt of court. He never had the opportunity to appeal because the Constitutional Court is the highest court in the country. So he could never have appealed that. And the Constitution says that there must be an appeal process, and even the African Charter says that there must be an appeal process. So that is a constitutional crisis that was created in only that one instance, and there were several others. Leave it as it may, I'm not here to specifically talk about the imprisonment of Jacob Zuma. I want to show you what has happened to the Constitutional Court over the years, and why we are now saying that the Constitutional Court is on life support. It's busy dying, and it will die. It has to die for us to really be liberated. And I will explain why. So let me start off with explaining the judicial system in terms of the Constitution of South Africa. It's correctly stated as the Constitution of the Republic of South Africa, 1996. It's not Act 108 of 1996 anymore. It's just the Constitution of the Republic of South Africa 1996. It has been changed by legislation, by an amendment to the Constitution several years ago. So anyone who's still saying that it's Act 108 of 1996, that's incorrect. But I'm not here to rectify the opinion of other so-called jurists. I'm here to just explain to you quickly where the Constitutional Court comes from and why it was initially created. Now, in terms of Section 165 of the Constitution, it says that it's the judicial authority and the courts are independent and subject only to the Constitution and the law, which they must apply impartially and without fear, favour, or prejudice. No person or organ or state may interfere with the functioning of the courts. And then the judicial system has been set out. You get the courts are the Constitutional Court, the Supreme Court of Appeal, which was previously known as the Appellate Division of the Supreme Court of South Africa. And then you've got the High Court of South Africa and any High Court of Appeal that may be established by an Act of Parliament to hear appeals from any court of a state is similar to the High Court of South Africa. The Magistrates Court and any other court established or recognized in terms of an Act of Parliament, including any court of a state, is similar to either the High Court of South Africa or the Magistrates Court. Now, what this basically also says is that there's a hierarchy, that the Constitutional Court is the apex, the highest court in the land. It used to be under the under the interim constitution of 1993 and in the beginning phase of our current constitution, the Constitutional Court was the highest court on constitutional matters. And the Supreme Court of Appeal was the highest court on appeal matters. So in the beginning, the mandate of the Constitutional Court was very much clear. The Constitutional Court had to come in and rectify all the previous regime's discriminatory laws. So above others, one of the first major cases was, for example, that the Constitutional Court came in and declared that the death penalty is unconstitutional and had to go away. So a court had to, the High Court made a death penalty and that had to go to the Constitutional Court eventually and they've declared it as unconstitutional. So since then, a number of very good cases came through to the Constitutional Court and our Constitutional Court became the pride of the nation, really the pride, because the Constitutional Court became a model court, not only for South Africa and Africa as a continent, but for the entire world. The Constitutional Court's judgments of the beginning were used in several other foreign countries' final judgments of their highest courts. So we became part of the lawmaking and the human rights of other countries as well via this great Constitutional Court that we have. But unfortunately, as one can expect, they became abundant because they regularly interfered actually with the works of the Supreme Court of Appeal. And let me just explain this, that the Supreme Court of Appeal, when it was created, the appellate division of the Supreme Court of South Africa morphed into the Supreme Court of Appeal. There were still a lot of old judges from the old regime. And when you understand how judges are chosen in common law, you cannot just get rid of a judge. If he doesn't want to go on retirement willfully, he has to stay his full term until he resigns or retires at the age of 70-odd. So at that point in time, the democracy of South Africa had a problem because they were sitting with all these old judges who were known to be death judges. Many of them have sentenced liberation fighters to the gallows during the segregation years, and so they realized that, you know what, we need a constitutional court, independent new blood coming in and make to be a new broom sweeping king. But unfortunately, as time went by, they started, the Constitutional Court have overstepped their boundaries in the sense that many of the cases that were supposed to be final appeal cases, straightforward appeal cases. At one point, I forgot about the specific judgment, but it basically came to the point whereby the Constitutional Court ruled that basically all cases have got a constitutional element to it. So it means that all cases has got the if you can identify the constitutional issues, the Constitutional Court is then the apex court, irrespective of whether it has been judged on appeal by the Supreme Court of Appeal. So then there became this struggle all the time between the Supreme Court of Appeal and the Constitutional Court. Many of their judgments clashed. In some instances, the judgments delivered by the Constitutional Court on matters that have been seen actually as appeal matters and final, those judgments of the Supreme Court of Appeal have been, in some instances, in not so diplomatic wording, being dismissed by the Constitutional Court. And in some instances that I've read those judgments, the Constitutional Court essentially said that the Supreme Court of Appeal was sort of reckless in making such a decision while constitutionally aligned, this should have happened. Okay, so over time, they had to make the Constitutional Court the apex court. And that happened around 2012, when there was an amendment to the Constitution whereby the Constitutional Court formally became the apex court on all matters. So the name of the Supreme Court of Appeal actually is not correct anymore, because it's not the Supreme Court of Appeal, because you can still take appeals up to the Constitutional Court. So it has become a secondary court, and that has created a lot of issues, as you can imagine. Because the Constitutional Court, in the beginning, it was very much easy for the Constitutional Court to say that this is a constitutional matter, we will deal with it. But eventually, because of the Constitutional Court saying that we have actually become the Supreme Court of all appeals, more and more cases went to the Constitutional Court. And as you can imagine, their workload has increased tremendously. And let me just show you the problem we are sitting with and have been sitting for a very long time, at least for the past, let's say, more than 10 years. In terms of Section 167 of the Constitutional Court, of the Constitutional Court, the Constitutional Court consists of the Chief Justice of South Africa, the Deputy Chief Justice, and 9 other judges. So it means that there are 11 full-time judges of the Constitutional Court. 11. Okay, only 11. However, there is the opportunity for the president, in terms of Section 175, the president may appoint a woman or man to serve as an acting deputy chief justice or judge of the Constitutional Court if there is a vacancy in any of those offices, blah, 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 blah. So it means that they can be acting judges by the president appointed. But generally, the number of acting judges have relatively stayed the same, at about 2 acting judges at the time. So you were basically sitting with a pool of 13 judges. Okay. And then the acting judges is supposed to be coming in when a judge cannot proceed anymore for some reason, maybe going on vacation, going on retirement, and another judge has not been appointed. So it was actually sort of limited when an acting judge could actually start to function. But in practice, it happened that they did appoint the additional acting judges due to the workload that the Constitutional Court started to experience. And let me just show you what problem we have. Seeing that there's 11 judges, full-time judges, and 2 extra acting judges, plus minus, the Constitution says specifically, a matter before the Constitutional Court must be heard by at least 8 judges. Must be heard. Heard. Okay. Now, this is somewhat different than what is suggested the Supreme Court of Appeal and the High Court may do. Both of them, the Supreme Court of Appeal, must be decided by the number of judges determined in terms of an act of parliament, must be decided. So it's a different word. It's not heard, must be decided. And then in the High Court context, it says that also the High Court may decide. The High Court of South Africa may decide any constitutional matter, any other matter not assigned to another court by an act of parliament. So both the High Court and the Supreme Court of Appeal may decide a case. So it means that they don't actually have to hear a case. Okay. So they can literally, both of these courts can just put the papers before them and just read it, and then they can decide on the papers without hearing the parties. Unlike the Constitutional Court, which specifically says that matters before the Constitutional Court must be heard by at least 8 judges. Now, what has happened was that the Constitutional Court, because of their workload and the impossibility, logical impossibility, of 8 judges of the pool of maximum of 13 constantly being put on each and every matter that comes before them. So the workload, the cases that came to the Constitutional Court, especially since 2012, when the 17th Amendment introduced and made the Constitutional Court the highest court, is the highest court of the Republic and may decide constitutional matters and any other matter. Now, there it came in that may decide. But it's in direct conflict with what it says it must be heard. Okay. So they've brought in this change to subsection 3 to make it the highest court in the land. Okay. But they've never rectified subsection 2. To say that it must be heard. So what has happened with this influx of cases, the Constitutional Court couldn't handle the workload. So they somehow, and we know from our investigation and part of this whole process, we know that there was seemingly an instruction to the registry of the court to say that when cases come in that have been decided by either the, or when cases come in that has not been before the High Court or the Supreme Court of Appeal before, in unless there is a critical constitutional issue that we have to decide, you must please just dismiss the case, say that these judges, name the judges, have considered this case and have determined that it's not in the interest of justice to hear the case now, or there's no prospect of success in that matter. And unfortunately, self-represented litigants have been the target of this, as we put it, the KFC drive-through court orders that the Constitutional Court has made. So, like I will show in this one case of Dr. J, that we were adamant and we knew that this had to be heard physically before a minimum of 8 judges, and suddenly it was just kicked to the sideline. In many aspects you can realize that these cases do have constitutional merit, and for some reason then you out of the blue you receive this by electronic mail, a court order that it has been decided and dismissed. No reasons given. That's the only thing. They've just, it's not in the interest of justice to hear this case now, and for that reason it has been dismissed or not granted, or there's no prospect of success in your appeal, and the application for leave to appeal must fail. They don't say why, and then they mention the names of a minimum of 8 judges as they are, but unfortunately there's no indication of this was just a majority, or because if they do split it into a majority, it means that there was others who said no, this wasn't right. So you couldn't actually determine whether you could ask for a rescission of that judgment on certain legal principles. Now, what has this have happened was that more and more of these cases have started to go through this court system, saying that it was adjudicated by a minimum of 8 judges mentioned by the names. And then you know for a fact that this cannot be. They should have determined this in another way. But because it's the highest court of the land, there was no appeal further. So in most instances, the continuation with this process was obsolete. You couldn't take it further. If there were court cost orders against you, you had to make provision to go and pay them, even if it was unjust and unlawful, basically, to have rendered that judgment. And that is what happened with Jacob van Heerden. Jacob van Heerden started off in the High Court with his case. We assisted them to take it to the Supreme Court of Appeal. It was dismissed there. Also, there's no chances of prospect of success. And then we went to the Constitutional Court, and they've also, irrespective of the fact that we've actually also asked for direct access, that the Constitutional Court must grant, in the interest of justice, grant auxiliary relief to basically say that the matter must go back to the High Court for a proper hearing, because the case was that there was no proper hearing. And irrespective of qualifying the reasons, they never adjudicated on the additional points. They just simply said that it's not in the interest of judges of justice to, or there's no prospect of the success, and the case was dismissed with costs. So poor Jaco van Heerden was put in this unfortunate position that he basically lost everything. He had to pay for the cost of the other parties, irrespective of the fact that we knew that it was wrong. The judgments of the other courts were wrong, respectfully said. So then we were sitting there and wondered, okay, but let's take this matter to the African Commission on Human and People's Rights. So we did that. So since 2019, we, Liberty Fighters Network, became involved in that case. We've represented him. We've drawn up his papers before the African Commission on Human People's Rights. And we've complained in that matter of the practice of the Constitutional Court, that they are kicking cases to the sideline without proper adjudication and without giving any reasons. And in terms of the African Charter, the administration of justice must have reasons. It's a given. There's no limitation of rights like we've got in our constitution. The African Charter is straightforward. You must have reasons. There must be administrative proper action, and everyone has got the right to access to court and also the benefit of the law. So this matter of Jaco van Heerden, eventually after prosecuting this case since 2019, eventually. During October, November, end of October to November, on the 81st ordinary session of the African Commission on Human and People's Rights, they have dealt with the merits of this case. And they've now made a decision yesterday that we've been informed of, that the fact that they've made a decision. And let me just quickly show you this communication. There it is, Mr. Reyno De Beer, still old address. We are used to stay in 2019. I write to inform you, and this is by the Executive Secretary, Ms. Abiola Ituku-Ojo. I write to inform you that during the 81st ordinary session held from 17th October to 6 November in Banjul, The Gambia, the African Commission on Human People's Rights, the Commission, considered the above-mentioned communication and adopted a decision on the merits. And then the Secretariat of the African Commission on Human People's Rights kindly informs you that the decision on the aforesaid communication will be brought to the attention of the African Union policy organs during the next AU summit in February 2025. And then, in accordance with Article 59(1) of the African Charter on Human People's Rights, which provides that all measures taken without the provision of the present charter shall remain confidential until such a time as the Assembly of Heads of State and Government shall otherwise decide, as read together with Rule 124 of the Commission's Rules of Procedure 2020, this decision shall remain confidential and shall be transmitted to you after the Commission's activity report, in which it is referenced, has been considered by the Assembly of Heads of State and Government of the AU. Please accept my best regards. So, the African Commission has now determined a decision. They've made a decision. And we, as Liberty Fighters Network, can only imagine, and we are certain that they found in our favor, because we've been part of the entire process. We know what the information they requested from us before to provide. And one element was that they wanted to make sure at one stage, where are the reasons of the judgments? And we said, but that is that. They haven't given any reasons for the decision. So then we've also complained about the fact that it's impossible for eight judges at a time, for each and every case, to adjudicate the matter. So they have been lying to us. If you can imagine that, let's say for arguments like there's only 500 cases that's put before them in a year, it means that it's more than one case for each and every day for the year, because there's 365 days. And if you put only 500 cases before them, You must remember that in each case, it's not just a simple few pages, because there's no specific restriction in the Constitutional Court of how many pages you must put before them. So you can literally put pages and packets and a lot of information before them that they have to go through. They have to be speed readers of the best speed readers in the entire world with the best comprehension and memory retention of any other person in the entire world, respectfully said, to do that for each and every one of these 500 cases, for example. So at some stage you must say, but they could not have gone. All eight judges there who unanimously made that decision could not have gone through all the pages all the time. So there should have been some sort of mechanism that they've implemented to just quickly deal with these types of matters. Hence why strange things have been happening, especially the past 4 years, whereby judgments are rendered, for example, in the one Sakeliga case, whereby they never even considered previous judgments of them. Which they have not explained why they've made that specific decision, but if they had used the judgment in a previous matter, they would have known that that standpoint of theirs in that judgment was incorrect, could never have been taken, because they have explicitly explained in a previous judgment why they could not have done that. Okay, so that's also one of the examples. Or for example, we've taken cases of eviction matters, residential eviction matters, through the entire system up to the Constitutional Court, especially specifically stating that the judgment in the Irvin Berea case has not been followed by the previous courts, because there was no investigation or inquiry in terms of homelessness in those instances, because they were evicted and they were put on the street immediately. So then, because we specifically said, but you as the Constitutional Court said in the Irvin Berea case that all the other courts had to have, they do not have the jurisdiction to issue an eviction order for a residential property if they have not done a proper inquiry in terms of homelessness. And the municipality had to put in a report in terms of an investigation that they have done regarding the homelessness, which were never done in those cases, but yet the Constitutional Court in one line has said, no prospect of success, dismissed. So unfortunately, there were various elements over the years that we have noted from our experience, which have indicated that the Constitutional Court did not consider these cases as they say they did. And in any event, we said, it should have been heard by a minimum of eight judges. There is no judgment by the Constitutional Court explaining the wording of heard. The one that they have always been using to say that they don't have to give reasons is apparently that the Constitutional Court is the highest court in the land, so there is no appeal, so there's no necessity to basically give reasons why they've decided in a certain way, because you can, it will never be used. So why bother giving reasons if there's no further appeal? So this has created a major problem. And at some stage or another, the judges of the Constitutional Court throughout the years had to have known that this will come to bite them in the bud at some stage or another. And we have now revealed what was going on. So there were literally thousands of cases the past couple of years, especially the past 12 years or so, whereby cases have been adjudicated by the Constitutional Court, making people believe that at least the eight judges unanimously decided on this case, knowing well that there were thousands and thousands of pages, most probably many of those cases, and they have just said no, that there's no prospect of success for appeal, it's not in the interest of justice to hear the case now, and they've just simply cleaned their desks by making these judgments. You can imagine how many meritorious cases, and I have been involved in at least around 13 cases that we have referred to the Constitutional Court over the past 5 odd years, minimum. And all of them were kicked to the sideline. All of them were unanimously decided that there's no merits in the case. Some of them have been adjudications, summary adjudications, without the other party even opposing the application. Some of them have been adjudicated on at the time, a day or two after it was lodged, meaning that that panel of judges immediately went and started to work exclusively on your case and went through all the matters, and they've considered all the law, everything. There wasn't proper heads of argument submissions before the court even, and they've just no prospect of success. So unfortunately, we had an extremely bad experience with the Constitutional Court, and especially when our last previous case, which the urgent one of 2 weeks ago is actually based on, the one for Dr. J, they, for the first time, the Chief Justice Zondo then issued directions to the parties to submit heads of argument, and he has even appointed an amicus curiae, a friend of the court. And this friend of the court, Bob Hassa, it's the Pan-African Bar Association of South Africa, have even, in their submissions that they filed, they've agreed with our heads of argument in many aspects. So then suddenly, after that case of Dr. J was lodged way back in October last year, and it has now received a judgment in a couple of weeks back, 4 weeks back or so, in which they just simply, we were ready for a hearing, to proceed to a hearing. For the first time in all the 30 cases that we've referred to the Constitutional Court, we had the opportunity to be heard and argue the case, and we knew that we would have been successful. And out of the blue, the moment when I've queried, when will the hearing date be? You've forgotten about the case. The moment when I've sent that email to the Chief Justice, current Chief Justice Meyer, immediately, shortly thereafter, I've received this judgment, no prospect of success. So then I thought, you know what, this cannot, because in Dr. J's case, she is now responsible to pay roughly more than R1 million of legal costs. And all of those judgments should of cost orders should never have been given against her in the first instance, because it originated as an equality court matter where the norm is that the judge is not supposed to even give a cost order. All parties must pay their own cost. That is the neutral position in the equality court. And that judge, have the initial judge, who was totally biased against me, she attacked me. She had an at-woman attack on me. She didn't like me. Just said that costs against Dr. J. And she never even clarified why she had to go another route than the norm to award costs. Leave it as it may. And along the way, a lot of other stuff appeared, which the directions given were very important. So let me just go to that specific court case. This is the court case in the Constitutional Court. And I just want to quickly get to that annexure. There was the Constitutional Court order in the Dr. J matter, whereby Madlanga, Kulapan, Majid, Mtlatla, Rogers, Sigobin, Taranto, Mainziki. I said the Constitutional Court has considered the application for condemnation and the application for leave to appeal, and has concluded that although there are no reasonable prospect of success on the merits of the application for leave to appeal, the delay in bringing the application for leave to appeal is minimal, the explanation for the delay is adequate, and there is no prejudice to the respondent. Consequently, condemnation is granted, but leave to appeal must be refused with cause for lack of reasonable prospect of success. So there is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9 judges who unanimously concurred that there's no prospect of success, without giving reasons why they do not agree with our submissions and the submissions of Babasa, the amicus curiae, the friend of the court. And the directions issued by former Chief Justice Zondo specifically address key. The written submission shall address the following issues. Key issues that have been raised here. Very critical, very important questions of law that have arisen from this case of Dr. J. And as I've indicated, that in many aspects, even the amicus curiae agreed with us on the main aspect of this case, why it should succeed on appeal. And it was just kicked to the sidelines. So By that time, as you can imagine, Dr. J was really disgruntled. And she was extremely upset because we have told her that this is a very good case and we've taken this to the Constitutional Court. There was a very good process for some time and suddenly, out of the blue, it was kicked to the sideline. So she was obviously very much disgruntled and upset about this. And she said that, Reyno, I'm not going to get involved in any further court cases about this. I'm mulled with a lot of legal costs in this aspect. I cannot afford to lose, even if there's a slight possibility of losing the case, there must be a 100% possibility that no judgment can be granted for costs against me. Then I will consider becoming part of that. But unfortunately, you have to see what you can do to challenge this further, but I cannot get involved. So we then immediately went and issued and lodged this application. And it's, as you can see, the Chief Justice of the Republic of South Africa is the first respondent, Minister of Justice and Constitutional Development, Minister of International Relations and Cooperation, African Commission on Human People's Rights, as an organ of the African Union, and then the other interested parties have been mentioned there. But what is important here is the relief that we are seeking, both in the urgent part and also in the normal sense. But what is key here is that we are asking the Constitutional Court to judge itself. We are saying that you know about the process that is ongoing before the International Forum, the African Commission on Human People's Rights, challenging your summary judgment orders. You are well aware of that fact. But irrespective, you have just forgot about that and done against our member exactly what you did with all our other 13 cases. Just keep it to the sideline. So we then said that that the operation and execution of the alleged order granted by the Constitutional Court in the Dr. J matter must be suspended pending the final outcome of this application. Meaning that as long as the process before the African Union is there, you cannot go and do exactly what we have complained against you. There should be a way, just like when you appeal a matter in South Africa, it's automatically, the execution and operation of that court order is automatically, not only in terms of legislation, but also in terms of common law, is then suspended pending the outcome of that appeal or the rescission or the review, whatever the case may be. So we also specifically said that that it be declared that the Constitutional Court is precluded from issuing any court order in matters before it absent an actual hearing, pending the outcome of both a complaint before the African Commission in the Van Heerden case, as well as the finalization of this application itself. And then there's a part B whereby we say that if the court does not hear it on an urgent basis, then the remainder must then be pending the outcome of the African Commission processes, and then after finalization thereof, we can then proceed. And then we're asking for final adjudication that the Constitutional Court may not deal with matters summarily without an actual hearing before 8 judges. So this application deals with the nitty-gritty of the judiciary of South Africa. And we have also further highlighted that there was a conflict of interest, because two of the judges that were sitting on the case of Dr. J, Justices Gulapan and Rogers, were actually precluded from actually adjudicating those cases because we had issues, personal issues, from Liberty Fighters Network side as the representative of Dr. J with them. We've reported Gulapan for misconduct, and also Rogers was personally involved as a complainant in my criminal prosecution for contempt of court. So both of them were, and the fact that they have judged it in that way, they have proved that they were biased because most probably of the conflict of interest they had with us as the representative for Dr. J. So that's another aspect. And so in this, unfortunately, Chief Justice Meyer is quiet. She hasn't responded, she hasn't made one reaction of any kind. She knows, I truly believe, that what we have discovered and what we have revealed is a critical to the democracy of South Africa. And this will result in a definite change of the constitution, that the Constitutional Court of South Africa has become obsolete. It has had its time. It has to resign, retire, and that the Constitutional Court and the Supreme Court of Appeal must be interlinked so that provision can be made to have more cases heard by a more judges panel for each and every one of them. And that the issue of summary dealing with these types of cases must be dealt with. There is no way in terms of either our constitution as it is or in the African Charter that they are allowed to adjudicate cases summarily without giving any reasons. They must give reasons for each and every one of those cases, and a mechanism should be established to deal with each and every one of those cases. They cannot be kicked to the sideline as they have been doing the past couple of years, especially. Imagine how many of these cases there are. If there is a very conservative number of 500 cases and only about 14 cases annually is actually heard and adjudicated by the Constitutional Court, literally adjudicated, then you can imagine that the percentage or the possibility of your case being summarily just dismissed and kicked to the sideline is astronomical. That there were so many of those cases, and because they were also the last stop, they were not taken further. So they couldn't do anything, because if they were unhappy about what the Constitutional Court did, what else can they do? Yes, we have taken the matter to the African Commission on Human People's Rights, and as you've said, as you've realized, we have been successful. So by February 2025, we are sure of it, that the referral of measures indicate basically that that there's measures that has been decided on against South Africa. I'm very much excited to, and will wait in patience to hear what those measures are. I'm sure of it that the African Commission has realized that this is a major problem, and this needs to be discussed on an African Union policy organ level, and not just by them only. Yes, it is the process normally that they have to follow, irrespective, but I'm confident that there will be repercussions for our judiciary, and especially and pertinently for the Constitutional Court. This brings up another very important issue, that isn't it fraud and or corruption and or terrorism and or treason that these judges of the Constitutional Court have committed over these years by having adjudicated these cases in this manner? I am sure of it that criminal charges should be laid against all the chief justices, all the judges and all the acting judges who participated in those practices. That is my honest opinion. Criminal charges should follow because of exposing what has happened here. And they cannot just come up and say, oh, sorry. How are they going to rectify the problem that they've created? Respectfully said, with all the hundreds, thousands actually of cases that they've just simply kicked to the sideline without proper adjudication. Technically all those cases are null and void if they have not been heard by a minimum of 8. All of them. So all of those cases is still pending before the court. Rightfully said. Constitutionally. Because if there were not 8 judges who heard those cases, then there was no proper adjudication in that process. So it means that automatically those court orders have not been aligned with the Constitution, and because it's not aligned with the Constitution, it's automatically invalid, null and void. Now, finally, this brings me to the other exciting news that has also happened, which have just been ignored by the mainstream media as all our matters. It's as if we do not exist, because everything, all the positive things that we are doing for South Africa and legal-wise, the media refuse to publish anything about this. And just A few days ago, the Electoral Court, a few days after the lodgement of that urgent application, the Electoral Court, a full bench of them, consisting of three presiding officers, have ruled that, number one, the complaints raised by Mr. De Beer, that is my complaint against all the IEC commissioners that I've lodged before the elections. Before the elections, I've reported the conduct of each and every one of the IEC commissioners to the Electoral Court. Irrespective of that process, the commission still, IEC, still continued on the 2nd of June to render their final findings that the elections were free and fair. They've determined, irrespective of the complaint against them before the Electoral Court, that no one knew about. The media did not report on this. What is critical here is that the complaint raised by Mr. De Beer, and I will put the link in so that you can just go and read this judgment yourself. And this judgment might have gone, the final decision was against me, but I'm taking this on appeal to the Constitutional Court, because the Constitutional Court must actually rectify what they've done wrong in the Jacob Zuma matter. Remember that Jacob Zuma was accused of not being eligible to be a member of parliament of the National Assembly because of his criminal record. And then the Constitutional Court eventually decided, after the Electoral Court said that he was eligible, the Constitutional Court then decided that, no, sorry, sir, you may not stand as a candidate to be a member of National Assembly because of your criminal record. And I have intervened in that case. But it was immediately, it was judged and said, no, I may not intervene in it. On two occasions, it has now been formally reported in a judgment by the Electoral Court that that is the case, what happened. That the complaint raised by Mr. De Beer. Paragraph 60, Mr. De Beer asserts that he acts in his own interest, in the interest of Mr. Zuma, the former president of the country, and in the public interest, including specifically that of the MK party, leaving aside whether Mr. De Beer is entitled to act in the interest of Mr. Zuma and the MK party without joining or serving them, and where there is no suggestion that they are unable to act in their own interest. Mr. De Beer is clearly entitled to act in his own interest and in the public interest. Mr. De Beer complaints contain entire applications submitted by him to the Constitutional Court. So they're confirming it. The first is an application to intervene in the matter of Electoral Commission of South Africa versus Umkhonto we Sizwe political party and others, the MK matter, which dealt with Mr. Zuma's eligibility to be a candidate for the National Assembly and which was heard on the 10th of May. The intervention application was dismissed on the 7th of May. So it was dismissed 3 days before it was heard on the 10th. The second is a rescission application Mr. De Beer brought on the 13th of May. So it was the Monday after the 10th, the Friday, to rescind the order dismissing his intervention application. That second application was dismissed on the 16th of May 2024. The Electoral Court has read those documents. When you read the entire judgment by them, you will realize that they are recording everything correctly, or mostly correctly. And what is evident here is the application for rescission, the commissioner's responses. That's very much important, and especially paragraph 51. The commissioners state under oath that they were unaware of the African Commission process until Mr. De Beer brought his applications to the Constitutional Court. Remember that I've just showed you that that was done on the 7th of May. They knew that 3 days before the hearing on the 10th. So they knew about, the IEC members knew about the African Commission process that was going on against on behalf of Mr. Zuma 3 days before the hearing. And then they also point out that that process was not relevant to what they were dealing with, and that once the commissioners became aware of the process, there was no obligation on the commission to raise it before the Constitutional Court. In any event, as Mr. De Beer has made clear, he himself brought the process to the attention of the Constitutional Court. So they even confirmed that the Constitutional Court knew about that. The Constitutional Court was informed about it, and the Constitutional Court never made it known, never considered that aspect in the interest of justice. Never. And then, importantly, paragraph 59, Mr. De Beer concludes that the defense against his complaint reopens the commission's previous decision about Mr. Zuma's candidacy. It is not clear why, particularly when the Constitutional Court has determined the issue. What I've said here was that that the fact is that the Constitutional Court was made aware of that process, and that by the 7th, when they were definitely aware of that, they've decided that it's not relevant for the rest. So there was a decision, a re-examination of Mr. Zuma's case at that point. So that the decision that they've made was a new decision at that point in time, which should have gone to the Electoral Court for reconsideration, inclusive of why they decided that the process before the African Union for Mr. Zuma was irrelevant. Now, it basically sets out that I have already set out as part of the procedural background Mr. De Beer's response. However, in the context of the commissioner's response, as set out above, I set out what is relevant. The complainant basically says that according to Mr. De Beer, the content and events surrounding those applications contain evidence supporting the complaint. The complaint is, according to him, related to a matter that was then pending before the African Commission. He asked that the applications be read in detail to understand the complaint. Mr. De Beer contends that there was an ongoing international process before the African Commission and that the commissioners were aware of this process. The process was apparently relevant to Mr. Zuma's eligibility to be a candidate for the National Assembly. Mr. De Beer complains that the commissioners failed to consider the process and failed to disclose its existence to the Constitutional Court, which he submits was necessary for the Constitutional Court to reach a balanced, independent and impartial decision. One assumes that in Mr. De Beer's view, the failure to disclose this to this court, the proceedings before the African Commission would also fall within that category. In fact, it is that failure which prompted him to bring his application to intervene. Mr. De Beer contends that this intentional concealment of relevant facts by the commissioners was intended to harm Mr. Zuma and the NK, to deny voters' rights to make an informed choice and thereby to interfere with the outcome of the elections, resulting in the process that was neither free nor fair. Then the Electoral Court has confirmed my argument, and now it's going to the Constitutional Court. We will challenge the free and fairness of the elections again, based on this new evidence in the judgment itself of the Electoral Court. So that will obviously have extreme effects on our democracy, because as we know that the MK party and Mr. Zuma have not been treated fairly, and in the process, had the electorate known about the African Commission process that was ongoing since 2022 already, challenging his imprisonment, and that that imprisonment sentence was supposed to have been suspended pending the outcome of the international process before the African Commission, they most probably, many of the voters would have aligned themselves with the MK party and voted in their hordes for them. In that perspective, the outcome of the elections could not be declared as free and fair, and the IEC members knew that, irrespective of this application, this investigation by the Electoral Court, they've just ignored it. They've never informed the public about this process. They've judged themselves. They've declared, where the Electoral Court was supposed to do it, they've made the decision on their own that they are independent and nothing was wrong. They could never have declared the elections as free and fair by the 2nd of June, 2024. Okay. People, this is in broader detail why this is important. What is going to happen is that this will prompt our government to start the process of rewriting the Constitution. Our Constitution has to be rewritten to write the Constitutional Court out of it, and to create a new court system that I truly hope this time around will include the people of South Africa. And we've also now seen, as what has happened in another African country, I forgot the African country's name at this point in time, they literally went to the polls to decide on the amendments to their constitution. And this is what I would have loved should have happened in 1996 already. The Constitutional Court approved the constitution, not the people of South Africa. The people of South Africa should have been the ones, by way of a vote, yes or no, are you in favor of the Constitution, yes or no? At least that should have been a determination of the constitution in the way it is. But that process was never forwarded to the people to consider. So in that respect, our constitution is not our own. The constitution has been written by the judiciary and approved by the judiciary, which we now know. There's a big question mark about the legitimacy of the actions of the constitutional court, specifically in this point of time. People, please share this, like this video. Please see whether you may assist us with a voluntary donation to keep us going with all this great work that we are doing. Without your support, we cannot proceed. We need your support. Please support us. We are supporting you. Please support us in turn. Thank you very much for listening to this video and sharing this, like this, become a member, consider becoming a member of our platform, and also subscribe at least. That's free of charge. Thank you very much. Have a nice day. God bless.
Liberty Fighters Network.
Liberty Fighters Network.